Hey guys, it's Danny. Today we're going to talk about the pros and cons of clay pots, or rather, growing orchids in clay pots. Some of you might remember that a few years ago, I did have all of my orchids in clay pots. And well, after struggling for almost 2 years, I decided to give them up. They just didn't work out all that great for me, but this does not mean that clay pots are not good or that they won't work for somebody else. As you might know, nothing comes without disadvantages. There's no such thing as perfect pot, perfect medium, and things of the sorts. What's important is to find ways to manage all of these disadvantages that our setups might have. A little side note before we begin, I will only refer to unglazed clay pots. The glazed clay pots do not behave at all in the same way. They behave more like plastic, actually. So everything that I will say only refers to the unglazed clay pots. So without further ado, let's start with the advantages of clay pots and why people actually really love them. One of the main attractions with clay pots when it comes to orchids is how ventilated they are. They are naturally porous, so gas exchange happens without you actually having to poke extra ventilation holes or slits or anything of the sorts. You might know that with plastic pots, it is very common to see extra ventilation slits, or if a plastic pot doesn't have those holes, many of us choose to make them ourselves, and this is because most of the orchids we grow are epiphytic. This means they don't actually grow in soil and their roots are adapted to tremendous amounts of air in comparison to most other plants we might grow. So when trying to confine the roots in a container, it is a super good idea to offer extra ventilation as much as possible. Otherwise, we do risk rotting the roots. Well, when it comes to clay pots, we don't actually need extra ventilation because the entirety of this material is very, very porous and keeps things inside very airy. We do still need drainage holes, and most clay pots do have at least one. I've also seen clay pots with extra ventilation holes. I do believe that's a little bit too much, particularly in warm climates, but I did see them. Maybe they're useful in very, very, very cool or humid climates. However, typically a standard clay pot should not need any type of extra ventilation since the material is just so incredibly porous. So I think you can see the attraction with the clay pot when it comes to many, many epiphytic orchids. Another pro would be the weight of clay pots. Generally speaking, they are much, much heavier than typical plastic pots. And when it comes to orchids, this can be the difference between a broken flower spike or not. As you know, some orchids do tend to create quite long flower spikes with big flowers, heavy flowers. Just think about Phalaenopsis orchids, which eventually all do tend to lean over. They do tend to be quite top heavy, so having a heavier bottom actually helps. Many times in plastic pots, all we need to do is just lightly brush against the orchid and it's on the floor, which, needless to say, is not pretty. And many times we do manage to either break flowers or buds, or worse, the entire flower spike. Now, of course, even with plastic pots, there is a workaround. We can use decorative containers. But what if we don't like them? What if we don't want to use them? Well, the clay pot practically eliminates the need for a heavier decorative container because it itself is heavy enough to support most orchids. There will always be those super big phalaenopsis that lean over, which will tip even the heaviest clay pot. But for the vast majority of orchids, the heaviness of the clay pot should be enough to maintain them in place and safe from falling on the floor. For some growers, myself included, the whole appeal of the clay pot is the temperature. Due to the fact that they are so porous and they actually soak up water, they're also prone to fast evaporation. With evaporation also comes cooling. And I'll be sure to link you down below in the description an article that talks all about evaporative cooling and how it actually works. But in the plant world, it is a very well-known fact that porous materials such as clay can have a very, very big impact on the ambiental temperature. And I also did a little experiment testing out just how much these clay pots can reduce temperature. So I started with an ambiental temperature this morning of about 21 degrees Celsius. You'll find the equivalent in Fahrenheit on the screen. I'm using an aquarium thermometer, by the way, and I inserted it in the medium, not touching the actual clay pot, and I just left it there for about 10 minutes. And look at the temperature inside the pot. It is around 17 degrees, and I've seen even bigger differences on warmer days. How evaporative cooling works is the faster the water evaporates, the lower the temperature will go. Hence why I was saying that these guys are super, super good for very warm or very hot climates, and particularly for cool growing orchids, since they have the ability to maintain the root system much, much cooler than the ambiental air. Also, around these orchids, the temperature tends to be a few degrees lower, but obviously you would need a bigger evaporative wall to actually make a big difference. So for now, I am just testing out a few cooler growing orchids with this before I think about investing into something else, because clay does have some cons as well for me, which we will get to. Another pro of clay pots, which maybe you already picked up upon from our discussion so far, is their ability to actually wick water. Clay material itself, being so porous, can actually hold water and wick it. Which means that if our pot sits in a pool of water, in a little while, it will completely wick all of the water it sits in, provided it's not super saturated. So let's do a little bit of a test. I just placed this clay pot in a dish of water. Let's give it about 10 minutes and then come back and see where the water level is. And here we are about 10 minutes later. We can see that the level of the water on my pot is quite high comparing to the level inside the dish. This is because the pot itself actually wicked the water. The clay material acts as a wick. And what this means is that no matter how much water you leave inside the dish of your orchid, the clay pot will continuously wick it and deliver it to your orchid. So you don't have to worry about your orchid having wet feet, as they say, because as it dries, the pot will actually wick out the water in the dish as well. And not only will it become soaked with water, it will also deliver this water to the medium inside. And Maya's very excited about it. So for this reason, typically people use sphagnum moss in association with a clay pot, because sphagnum is just as wicking as the clay pot, if not more. This is what I'm using as well, but on top I do place bark just to limit algae. But you can see how this combination can be successful with orchids, because you can use the tray as a little bit of a reservoir. And as the water evaporates from the pot in the medium, new water is available in the dish, it will be wicked up, and your medium will be replenished. Another very important pro of clay pots is that they're not damaging to the environment, or at least not as damaging as their plastic counterparts. Clay is a natural material, and I will not go into the process or the manufacturing aspect of things, but just the product itself and what do we do with it after it cracks or after we're done with it. Well, many people actually break it into pieces and use those pieces in their garden as drainage materials. You can use the pieces at the bottom of other pots, again for drainage reasons, and in time what will happen is that this material will completely become a dust. It will just integrate with the soil of your garden, so you can see how, compared to plastic, it really is a much more ecological friendly option. And the last pro that I will mention, clay pots arguably look a little bit better. Some would say even more natural. And that is a very subjective thing that I just said. Of course, you're not gonna see clay pots growing on trees, so it's not that type of natural. But I think you will agree that it tends to blend a little bit better than your typical plastic pots in a natural setting. Clay has a very earthy color as well, so to me it looks very nice as a contrast with the green foliage and the beautiful flowers. It doesn't take away from the shine of the plant. The main focus is still the plant. In time, clay can get a sort of patina. I don't know if that's the correct way of referring to things. They get a little bit stained. We're gonna talk about it. And that can give them an antique, an aged look, which can look very beautiful. And of course, if you have that preference of style, I'm sure that clay pots are a much, much more suited option for you than typical plastic or other materials, which tend to look rather modern and not so natural. But as everything else in this world, clay pots do have their downfalls. They have disadvantages that, for some of us, such as myself, can be total deal breakers. And here again, I will be subjective about it. Of course, some of these cons might not be cons to you, and that's absolutely fine. But for me, these were the things that made me completely give up clay pots with the vast majority of my orchids. And I will start with the number one deal breaker for me. And this is evaporation rate, which is paradoxical because the evaporation aspect is one of the main attractions with the clay pot. Well, anything that is good, if it's excessive, it can become very bad. And that's exactly what's happening for me in my climate. Being that most of the times it's very warm and even super hot in the summertime, I find myself struggling to maintain these pots, well, wet. Because here's the downside of being so porous. Not only are we wicking water, delivering it to the medium, but if for whatever reason the water source disappears and the clay pot starts to dry, what it does is the reverse. It sucks water from the medium and it contributes to the overall drying time of the entire pot. There is no valve inside these pots. It's not a one-way thing, it's a two-way thing. So wicking will happen, whether it's from a dish or from the medium of your orchid. Even though at first I managed to keep up with watering these pots when summer kicked in and also when my orchids started to produce many, many roots and started to drink more water, well, I had to water my orchids as fast as even every day or every 2 days. And that posed quite a few problems for me because I simply do not have this availability. I do have quite an extensive orchid collection, and not only, I am using reverse osmosis water, which some of you might know needs to be stored. It's not produced very fast. It's not like another faucet that has the same flow as your regular faucet. And also the production of reverse osmosis water implies loss of tap water. So me using excessive osmosis water was just not economical at all. My filtration system simply could not keep up, and in the end, that was the major issue that I had with my collection in clay pots. This can absolutely be a non-issue if you don't have a lot of orchids, if you naturally have soft water at your faucet, or you don't actually need super big quantities to water your orchids. For me personally, there was another issue. I could not supplement with tap water because I do have pretty hard water. It's not extreme, but it is a little bit more than what I would like, and clay pots show the hard water, as we will see in another con. So using tap water was not ideal. Using the reverse osmosis water simply was not enough, but I'm sure not all of you will run out of water like I did. Related to the tap water hardness issue, clay pots have a tendency to get stained by salts. So with clay pots, you will often see those white residues, which to some extent can look really nice. The stains themselves weren't a big issue for me, but as I started to try out the tap water and as I started to fertilize my orchids, the situation got a little bit out of hand and I had a lot of salt buildup to the point of actually forming crusts. I personally did not enjoy that look. It did not look like the beautiful pictures you see on Instagram. So every once in a while, I had to go ahead and remove them and clean up the clay pots. And since I have a big collection, that took up a lot of time, which I could have used for something better, like filming more videos. And that is not all. If you think that crust looked ugly, well, in time, things got even worse. With orchids that I continuously had to keep moist, such as Miltoniopsis or Oncidiums, I started to have all sorts of slimy deposits on my clay pots. Those weren't salt deposits, they were literal molds that smelled awful, looked awful, felt awful, and on top of them, there was also algae, which made the situation even slimier. So again, every once in a while, I had to go ahead and wash the pots at the sink. And that wasn't a pleasant thing to do because the pots had orchids in them. Some pots were heavy, some orchids were hard to work with. And when you're dealing with 150 orchids, the last thing you want to do is wash the pots every month. Another con, which I'm sure some of you will consider a non-issue, is the sterilization factor. Clay pots are generally a little bit harder or more cumbersome to sterilize. Usually what you would do with them is boil them or put them in the oven, maybe even using some substances such as bleach and submerging them. However, it's not as easy as just washing them at the sink, hey presto, 30 seconds later, totally disinfected pot like we do with the plastic pots. Because clay pots, being porous, and depending on that porosity, of course, they can harbor pathogens a little bit inside as well. So it is a better idea to actually put them through a boiling process or heating them up and destroying pathogens in this way. If you don't have a lot of orchids, I'm sure this is easy to do, but if we're talking about hundreds of orchids like I have, if I want to reuse a clay pot with another orchid, I have to boil it. And really, no matter how I go about it, it just takes more time than washing the pot at the sink. This, however, is not the end of the world. So if this was the only con that I had with the clay pots, I would have been absolutely fine. I don't switch pots as often as I water orchids, right? But coupled with the other cons, you can see how this was just another drop in the bucket. Another con that is super important for orchids is root breakage whenever we repot orchids. I'm using now organic media for some of the orchids that I'm keeping in clay pots, but at some point, this medium will need replacing. When that happens, I am sure that I will break much, much more roots from these orchids than the ones potted in plastic. It's really easy to detach orchid roots from plastic pots. If you squeeze a little bit on the plastic pot, you can see it's very flexible. The roots just detach, and because the plastic is smooth, you will not have roots just being super stuck. Well, with clay pots, you can have roots stuck. What we do is completely soak up the pot. This helps the roots detach, become more flexible. But in the end, if I am directly comparing a plastic pot with the clay pot, then the difference is absolutely major. It depends what your luck will be. Another con of clay pots can be their weight. Paradoxical, because it can also be a pro. There are instances where weight actually matters. So take for example this little Vanda. It's really easy for me to hang it. Also the shape of the pot is really useful and really easy to find hangers for, whereas the clay pot, not that easy. But just imagine having hanging orchids falling on you. If this fell on my head, I would be a little annoyed. If this fell on my head, hopefully I would be in the hospital and not worse. Yeah, sorry, that got a little too dark. But it's absolutely true, and it's something you should absolutely keep in mind. If you have pets, if you have children, having these things hanging and having people under them, no. And just to prove my point, let's weigh these two orchids. So first, let's weigh my Vanda in the plastic pot. And this one weighs 271 grams. Mind you, the medium is the same. It's my bark and sphagnum moss mixture. And the orchids themselves, they don't weigh all that much. This is a Meltoniopsis. It's very, very light. So let's see how much this one weighs. Look at that. It's 801 grams. So you can imagine if this falls on you, it's not going to be pretty. And the difference between the two setups is the clay pot and also the quantity of water that this clay pot can hold. And the last con that I will talk about is the durability of a clay pot. In my experience, these guys tend to crack a lot faster than a good quality clay pot. This, of course, will depend a little bit on the quality of the clay pot itself. But one thing's for certain, if you drop a clay pot on the floor, it will shatter. Whereas if you drop this thing on the floor, probably nothing will happen. And you can see on my clay pots, I already have a little crack here, which in time will get worse and worse and worse. One thing that speeds up the process is temperature difference. In my climate, I don't experience freezing conditions, but in other climates, you will. And one of the issues in wintertime with clay pots is cracks due to freezing temperatures. This probably will not affect you as a house plant grower, but I also noticed that the more I sterilize these pots, through boiling or heating them up, the more they tend to crack. Now, I will use them until they split open, which I had happening. But I have to say that some of my plastic pots are 8 years old at this point, and they're still going strong because they are good quality and because I take good care of them. I don't throw them away, I always reuse them. I don't think some of these clay pots will last me 8 years. You have to weigh in all of these features that I talked about, and if you have other cons or other pros that I didn't mention in this video, of course feel free to leave me a comment down below and tell us about your experience with clay pots and what you love most about them and what you hate most about them. So those are my thoughts on clay pots. As you can see, I still use some of them with some orchids. I have a lot of clay pots just sitting downstairs. My neighbors don't need them, I offered them, so they're just sitting there. Might as well use them for something, at least for some experiments. And currently, due to this wonderful evaporating cooling effect that they are capable of doing, I am trying to keep my cool growing orchids. I decided to give it another go with the Victoria Reginae, see how we do. I have my Miltoniopsis, so far so good. So because I have under 10 orchids that could benefit from clay pots, I can stay on top of watering and cleaning these pots. If it turns out that they're worth it with these orchids, hey, why not? But obviously, I really, really highly doubt that I will put all of my collection in clay pots. Can you imagine my outside cattleyas in clay pots in summer? Because I can't. So with that said, I hope this video was useful for you guys. Always remember that all pots, media setups have pros and cons, and it's about how you can overcome these cons, which of them can actually apply to you. I'm sure some of them absolutely don't. And I hope this will give you an idea about whether you need something like this, whether you'd like to experiment maybe with an orchid, and hopefully prevent you from investing a large sum of money into something like this and then discovering it doesn't work, like I did. But hey, it happened, it's okay. What to do? Might as well learn from it, right? So with that said, thank you so much for watching. Hope you've enjoyed this video. Subscribe to my channel for more orchid videos, tutorials, experiments, updates, and other fun orchid subjects. If you wish to support the channel, do consider becoming a member or visit the merch store linked down below in the description. You can also follow me on Instagram and Facebook. It's always nice to stay in touch there as well. And with that said, I'll see you next time. Bye!